Hello Lifestylers, Lushan. If you've just found my channel, welcome. And if you are returning, welcome back. Thank you so much for supporting me here on Lushan's Lifestyle. I truly do appreciate it. So today's video is my highly, highly, highly requested debt confessions video. So yeah, I had to kind of do a little research and pull some numbers and whatnot, but yeah, so if you are interested in my debt confession, keep watching. All right, so I have my notes in front of me. So if you see me looking down, that is why I am. And I got these lights on. And normally, you know, I'm usually not in front of the camera. And normally I don't need light because of the way my office is situated. But I'm in my living room right now. So just kind of wanting to give it a little background, a little ambiance or whatever. And so I had to break out the studio lights and it's hot. So anywho, my debt confession starts with Hurricane Irma. Before Hurricane Irma, I was pretty much, I didn't have a whole lot of debt. I don't know, maybe anywhere from $2,000 to $4,000, nothing that I couldn't manage or easily pay off if I needed to. And it was just a credit card. I didn't have a car payment. I hadn't had a car payment in like years, like I don't know, 10 or 15 years, and these lashes are getting on my nerves already. Let's walk it back. And in 2017, we suffered a hurricane here, at least in Florida. I know other states had, but it hit landfall in the Keys, September 2017. And at first, the way they had it tracked, it was like it was gonna go like hit the Keys, like the Key, you know, you all know how Florida is shaped, you know, on the downward, on that left spout part, and then you have the little Keys down here. So it was supposed to hit the Keys but keep going across into the Gulf, but it didn't. It hit the Keys and it hit as a category 5, and then it just came straight up Florida. And Irma was ginormous. She went from the East Coast to the West Coast of the state. So she covered the entire state as she went up. And by the time she got to Orlando, she was a category 1, but it's hot, y'all. But she had sustained winds of 85 miles per hour. So those of you, y'all know sustained means they ain't going nowhere. It's not wind gust, you know, you get a little gust. It was constant. It was constant. And she hit Orlando she hit Florida on September 10th. She hit Orlando. She got to Orlando by September 11th that morning. And she was at 85 miles per hour sustained. So it was, when I tell y'all, she was beating the crap out of us. It was just constant, constant, constant. So by the time it was, she moved up further up Florida and up into, I think it was Georgia she hit next. Hold on one second.
One eternity later.
Okay, I'm back. Whew, I had a eyelash in my eye. So anywho, so basically it was just torrential winds and rains the whole time she was here. And I want to say it lasted probably like anywhere from 8 to 10 hours, if I'm not mistaken, that it was just constant wind whipping and stuff flying and rain, and it was horrible. So by the time everything cleared up, we went outside to assess the damage. And in my subdivision, there's 149 houses here, And when I tell you, pretty much every house, I want to say at least 125 of the homes, the roofs were just decimated. It was pretty bad. There were shingles everywhere, nails, and all this building stuff that it takes to build a roof. We had it everywhere. It was like a disaster area. So immediately we knew, you know, we were gonna most likely have to get a new roof. So at this point, we called our insurance company, of course, and you know, it was just mayhem because Irma had just wreaked so much havoc throughout Florida and even before she had gotten here. So the insurance companies were overwhelmed. Emergency, you know, support was overwhelmed. It was just a lot. So it took me a while to kind of get through to my insurance company so they could come out and assess the damage. And they came out, I want to say maybe like, they had us on the schedule, I want to say like maybe 2 to 3 weeks. It took before we actually had the adjuster come out and take a look at the house and the damage. In the meantime, we noticed that there was some leakage. It had like within the third day, we noticed we had laminate like in our family room and in the living room, and we noticed it had started to buckle, so we knew there it was leaking somewhere. The adjuster came out and basically was like, yeah, you guys, you know, your roof is gone, you need a new one. And they actually had where they found where it was really leaking really bad, they had to like do the blue tarp, so we had the blue tarp on there. And so it took a while because like even the roofing companies, like they were overwhelmed with people getting their roofs redone. So from the time we got our estimate, it was like about $10,000, a little over $10,000. And of course, then you have the deductible. For those of you who have hurricane insurance, you know there's they have a $5,000 we have a $5,000 deductible. So basically, if the roof to repair it was going to cost $10,000, the insurance company was only going to pay the $5,000, and we had to come out of pocket for the other $5,000, which we had that money in our household savings, but we didn't have like tons and tons of money in the household savings. So so we were able to get that done. But again, like I said, it was like craziness trying to get a roofing company because some of them, they were gouging people. Some of them were shady. They were taking money, deposits, and not fixing the roofs. And so I really had to do my homework as far as, you know, getting a reputable quality roofing company. So our roof really didn't get fixed until I want to say it was April of 2018. So that's how long the process took. It was forever. So at this point though, we had already known when the adjuster came out, he was like, well, we can't replace your flooring because you guys are not in a flood zone, so you don't have flood insurance. And this came from the water that was just sitting like around our yard. Like our sewage head was just so overwhelmed with all the rain, the water, that a lot of water kind of sat a little bit before it actually drained. So what happened was, I guess the water just kind of seeped in through like the pores in the concrete. And so they recommended what we do, like pull the, you know, dig back, pull and put this stuff, you know, like that rubber sealant on there or whatever. But they weren't gonna replace anything inside of the dwelling because they considered that flooding, and we didn't have flood insurance because we're not in a flood zone. So anyway, basically the whole back part of our house is like, that's like where the master bedroom is and the family room is and like the kitchen nook and whatever. I think if you guys go back on some of my videos, and maybe I'll do a home tour if you're interested, comment below if you want me to do a home tour. But anywho, so we had to pull up everything. Our entire downstairs was a complete gut. And I have some pictures just showing it was our living room, dining room, our foyer area, the laundry room, the powder room, the kitchen, the nook, the family room, our master bathroom, bedroom and bathroom. So downstairs, total gut. So we had to pull up all the flooring. We had to pull up, take off all the baseboards. And this was after they fixed the roof. We didn't do anything until they had, they fixed the roof because we wanted to make sure that all the damage had been repaired, replaced and repaired. So we knew we were gonna have to really do some extensive remodeling inside. And that's when we started utilizing credit cards and personal loans. We did not want to take a mortgage out on the house. That was just, we had already hands down, no mortgage, second mortgage. So we had to do it just through like working and, you know, putting it on debt, putting on our consumer debt. So the downstairs, first they had to demo because we did have some spaces that had tile, like our heavy walk area. So they had to come in, demo, pull up all the laminate, and then scrape up the tile that was there, take off all, we actually took off the baseboards and we took up the laminate just to save some money, but still from them coming in and like popping up the tile, it was still in there, you know, labor and everything. It came out to like $1,200. Then we had to find what we wanted to replace it with. So, you know, I started researching and we ended up using floor decor, and we wanted a wood look. Like I wanted wood, hardwood, but then I was like, okay, we may just sustain the same thing again. Let's put something that's more, you know, sustainable, that's gonna last and durable. And we don't, if we have this issue, we don't have to worry about flooring again. So we ended up getting a dark wood look tile. So if you come to my house right now, or if I, it looks just like wood. You never know until we say it's tile. So we ended up getting that, but again, we had to do the entire downstairs. So between the tile, all the material, we had to get all new baseboards throughout downstairs, everything. So, and then labor. So with all of that, that was about $15,000 just for flooring alone. We needed to get the entire interior painted because, and I'll insert some more pictures, but we had gone from like an earthy, woodish tone, and then I kind of went, you know, as you grow, sometimes your styles and your tastes change, so I wanted to go more of a glam look. So we went with a gray paint that was the new neutral. Back then, like beige or tan was the neutral. But now grays were the new neutral. So we went with the gray, and from there I thought that would be a great juxtaposition between the dark floors, the gray walls, and then like I could throw my glam stuff in, and I could always like use accent pieces to switch out the colors because I'm always changing up accessories and decor, so it's easier to change the decor. So I just trying to think ahead of not getting pieces that were going to kind of hold me to a certain color. So by the time we did that, the painting, the interior painting, was about $2,800 because not only did we do downstairs, we went ahead and did upstairs as well because we didn't want it to look wonky. So that was about $2,800. And then the kitchen cabinets were brown, and I'll insert a photo there. They were brown, so I had always wanted them painted. At first I was like, I want to replace them. And then this guy came out and he was super honest and to do an estimate. And he was like, why would you take out these cabinets? These are in excellent condition. They're real wood. If I put something in here, it's not going to be equivalent to what you have. So he says, get them painted. Just make sure you get a really good company that specializes in painting cabinets so that they don't look trashy. So that's what I did. I researched and got a company that's their specialty is refurbishing and painting real wood cabinets. So doing that, they did the kitchen cabinets, and then they did for free, or they tacked it in because he had extra paint. He had like an eggshell, so he did all my vanities in the bathrooms for free because those were the same wood. And so he was like, why take out, you know, he said the same thing. He was like, why take out this vanity? It's real wood. So he painted those eggshell, and then the kitchen cabinets he did white. And it was a process. I'm tell y'all, we lived in a demo downstairs for like a month and a half. It was just excruciating. It was horrible, but when we started seeing everything coming together, it was like worth it. But you know, you have to have some patience living through a demo. I'm just gonna tell you right now. But in the end results, it was all worth it. So by the time all that added up, that was about $23,000. So that's how my that was all of that. Now, mind you, we don't have furniture. We don't have anything. We have nothing. We even sold them. We had black appliances, and I wanted stainless. So we had nothing downstairs. When I tell you it was a good, y'all see the pictures. There was nothing. So now we had to now refurnish everything because we have a living room. We have a dining room. We have the kitchen, we have a nook, we have a family room, we had our mat. So everything was gone. We had to replace everything, and that ended up being like total, like replacing everything or buying new furniture and everything was about $17,000, because my taste is a little kind of, you know, I'm bougie, I'm be straight up, y'all know I tell y'all all the time, I am extra and I do the most. But so yeah, I figure I'm gonna put stuff back in. I want nice stuff that's gonna last and it's gonna be pretty and it's gonna be what I like. So there's that. Anywho, so all in total, that was roughly around $40,000. And I have my own trusty dusty debt tracker. So by the time I started tracking what had been spent, the only thing that we did not do was, which I really wanted, was to have my countertops done in the kitchen. But something just told me, girl, sit down and start adding stuff. Just because you guys can afford the monthly payments does not mean that you should keep incurring this debt, you know, because of your wants. So I sat down and I just wrote down all the balances and like choked almost. You know, I was just like, girl, what the freak? So I was like, okay, we're going to hold off on that. We got to bring this down. We got to rein this in, get it under control, because it was just a lot. So I would highly suggest anyone who thinks that, okay, just because you can afford the monthly payments and not worried about the balance, that you don't do that. Sit down and see what that balance is, because anything can happen. Something can happen, you can lose your job, you know, I mean, you prepare for it, but still, it's gonna be a detriment. You're dealing with paying debt on top of trying to live. So I would say, sit down, figure out what's going on with your debt, and try to get rid of it if you can. So that was my wake up call. When I really wrote it down and saw it in black and white, I was like, time out. We need to rein this in. So at the time when I started actually looking at my debt, it was like, I wanna say it was like in October of 2019. And then I was on YouTube. I was always on YouTube, but I was on the beauty channels. I was on the budget stuff. So then I started looking at that and I was like, you know what? I need to do this. And so that's why I actually started the channel in January, because I was like, I want to help hold myself accountable and I want the community to hold me accountable as well. And I feel like, and it was something I wanted to do. I love YouTube. So So yeah, so when I started my, here's my debt tracker from, this is from 2019. And when I started, my consumer debt was $40,905.72 when I started. That was consumer debt. And then my student loan debt was $28,137.10 when I actually started. So now my consumer debt, and this is a year and a half later, my consumer debt is at $19,610.78. So in a year and a half, I've paid $21,294.94 down on my debt. So so I'm happy about that. That's a little bit more than half on my consumer. So I'm not mad at that at all. Now my student loan debt came about, I really didn't have student loan debt. But I took a course at Rollins College and I needed to do it for work for a leadership certification that I was after. So it was a semester course, and so it was like around $4,000, I want to say, $4,500 or something along that line. So I just got a little small loan, to student loan, to pay for the course and the books and all that stuff to do that. So that's why my 1A financial is about $4,000, because that was from a course that I took at Rollins College. The other A financial, actually my debt started out because I promised my son I'd pay his loans back as well. So in 2019, my student loan debt started at $28,137.10, as I previously stated. And currently it is at $14,909.62. And that is because my son took back, there were four loans, two creditors, with two loans within each creditor. That makes sense. He took back one of them. The one he took back totaled $11,526.35 that came off of what I had been tracking and, you know, paying back. So that took my debt down to the $14,909.62 plus what I've been paying already. So I am paying back my one little loan that I got for my certification course at Rollins College. And then I'm paying back one of his creditors, Ed Financials, which y'all who have been looking at my debt snowball and my debt tracker, I say that all the time, so you're well aware of that. So currently, like I said, that's where I stand with the student loan debt, and that's how it came about. Otherwise, I wouldn't have any student loan debt with that. So right now, as of July, my debt is at $34,520.40, and it started out at $69,042.82. So I've pretty much paid off more than half of it in a year and a half, aside from what went to my son, the $11,000 that went to him. But yeah, so that is my debt confession. That's how it all came about, y'all. That's how it all came about. And you've been watching the journey as I've been paying it back. So I hope this video confession or of my debt has enlightened you all as to how this happened. And you know, I thank you all for your wonderful comments, your positive thoughts, your encouragement to get it paid off. I know a lot of us are on this journey, so it's great to have this support system, and I truly do appreciate it. So remember, keep watching those ads. Thank y'all. Watch those ads. I appreciate it. You know, subscribe. If you're watching and you haven't subscribed, subscribe and share with, you know, some friends or family members that might need a little extra motivation or inspiration. I hope that, you know, my channel is providing. Yeah. So until my next video, hugs and love. Bye.